Okay, let's go.
Right now, I am scanning my brain inside a plane that's about to dive toward the ground to test how weightlessness helps or hurts your brain. They're testing it for astronauts in outer space. And that's just one of the 5 crazy science experiments that I got to test inside this plane. I recently went on the zero-G plane to explain a big debate about gravity. And while I was there, I got this exclusive access to experiments that can only happen in zero gravity. Stuff that I just knew you would love. So, in this extended cut, I'm gonna take you inside of this falling laboratory to show you these experiments and explore how they could be huge, if true. The experiments that I'm gonna show you are run by the European Space Agency, and I am the only civilian that they invited on this flight. The plane that I'm getting on is divided into 2 big sections. This area at the front is for all of the experiments, and then in the back, they have this normal plane seating. After we take off, the plane follows a path that looks like this, with this steep climb where you feel squished to the floor, like you're experiencing double gravity. And then as the plane reaches this point and then dives, you feel completely weightless for about 22 seconds.
Oh my God. Hi. All of my thoughts just left my head. I feel, this is amazing.
The plane does this over and over and over again, 31 times. And during these little moments of zero gravity, all of the scientists quickly run to do their experiments, and then they stop once the plane flattens out again and gravity returns to normal. It's like a big game of red light, green light, but with gravity. Each of the experiments get their own section in the plane, and each of them blew my mind in their own way. Starting with this. A sleeping bag that sucks your blood away from your brain, which is really important because on Earth, like I am right now, gravity is naturally causing my blood to move away from my brain. But in zero gravity, something weird happens. All of a sudden, all of your blood isn't getting pulled away naturally anymore, which is a really big problem. I never thought about this when I saw footage of astronauts in space, but astronauts say that being in space for a long time feels like being hung slightly upside down. That's so uncomfortable. And it affects the way that you think. So scientists are testing this thing, which sucks all the air outside of the bag, which creates a pressure imbalance between the parts of you inside the bag and the parts outside the bag. So to reach a new equilibrium, that negative pressure is pulling some of your blood away from your brain, meaning that your insides feel like they're experiencing normal gravity.
I feel the sleeping bag getting sucked down around me. I feel my shoulder pads getting pulled down toward it as well. Oh, this feels nice.
They first tested the concept with this big box version. And on this flight, they wanted to figure out if the sleeping bag works as well as the box.
And how's it going?
So far, so very, very good. It seems very promising. It feels 100% like standing on the surface of Earth.
The goal is to eventually turn the bag into a pair of pants. So you could imagine astronauts and people on the moon or Mars walking around with their insides feeling normal because they're wearing their gravity blood-sucking pants. That'd be awesome. Huge if true. But you and I could end up wearing these even if we never go to space. On Earth, if you get a serious brain injury, your brain might start to swell up, and doctors might need to urgently reduce that pressure. So one of the things they can do is they drill a hole into your skull. This is not going to be an alternative to that, but maybe it could help reduce the pressure earlier so that some patients never make it to that critical point. You could imagine that this could be used in hospitals. It could help a lot of people right here on Earth, and it could help us in space. And that's just experiment one inside of this falling lab. Next up is this.
Really professional. Awesome.
It's a workout machine that can do over 100 exercises, like this.
Oh, this is a workout.
Astronauts need to spend 2.5 hours a day working out in space. And that's because without gravity, our bodies can quickly lose bone density and muscle mass. 2.5 hours. On the International Space Station, they have this treadmill, this bike, and this weightlifting machine. But all 3 of them aren't great. They take up a lot of space, and it's not a lot of options to stay healthy. And to make things worse, all of that movement shakes the ISS, which is trying to navigate a very precise orbit and also host very delicate experiments. To counteract that, these machines need to have some type of vibration isolation, like the 900 kilograms of stuff underneath the treadmill used to dampen these forces. And we had to send all of that stuff into space for a treadmill. What happens when we have more people going farther into space? We need smaller, smarter options. Like for the upcoming space station around the moon, which is a real NASA plan. Basically, this experiment is testing space Pilates to keep us all fit if we go to space.
That's quite hard work, isn't it?
That's a workout. I can report, this is good exercise.
I think I'd like this in my house.
And I also think this machine could be helpful here on Earth in very confined spaces, like submarines, for example.
We've had people interested from special forces because you can really condition someone, bring them back to their peak condition on using this equipment. So it's very exciting.
Moving down the lab, the next thing I saw required me to wear this head cap with all of these sensors on it. This experiment tests how zero gravity affects your brain, specifically how well you can tell if something is upright or not compared to you, which is really important for all of the delicate tasks that astronauts do in space. First, you strap your head into this little cap that measures electrical activity in your brain. Then you stick your face into this thing, and then you watch a screen with a little line on it, and every time it changes, you hit the button on the side to say whether you think it's tilted or straight.
You will put your head inside and do the task for 20 seconds of microgravity exposure. It's not easy.
But this task is special because it triggers a part of your brain that we know relates to our ability to process gravity. So by seeing if you can correctly identify the position of the line and pairing that data from your EEG plus previous MRI images of your brain, scientists can learn how microgravity affects our ability to perceive verticality. Let me show you something. This is my real phone home screen, okay? There's Audible. And I've been listening to Audible for years, which is why I was so excited when they wanted to sponsor this episode. Just looking at the books that are in my library that I've already marked finished, I have spent weeks of my life listening to Audible. And my latest audiobook is this one. This is What Could Go Wrong by Scott Z. Burns. He was the screenwriter for Contagion, which I've always admired because it was just so incredibly well-researched and prescient. And in this book, he teams up with an AI named Lexter, and he tries to write the sequel to Contagion and then go pitch it to a bunch of Hollywood execs. It is very unexpected and funny and just interesting if you are curious about AI and humanity. I don't want to spoil it too much, so let me just say, if you like this show, I think you'll like this book. It just tackles a lot of the subjects that I care about. AI and creativity, the future of humans, cutting-edge tech. If you want to listen with me, go to audible.com/Cleo or click the link in my description. And now, the next experiment in the lab might be my favorite. This is John McFall. He's training to become the first astronaut ever with a robot leg in space. He is unbelievably cool. He is a former trauma surgeon, he's a Paralympic sprinter, and today we get to watch him put his robot leg to the test. He's running on a treadmill in zero gravity, like the astronauts do every day. But
no amputee has lived and worked on the space station before.
So to make sure that things go smoothly when he gets there,
we want to test the running prosthesis on a treadmill in simulated microgravity and look at lots of different parameters of the running prosthesis.
Specifically, he's testing four things: the stiffness of his blade, the resistance of the hydraulic fluid in his knee, the speed of the treadmill, and the force of these straps pulling him down toward it.
We want to be as prepared as possible if I do get the chance to go.
What makes this so exciting is that John is really close to going. He's already met all of the requirements to fly as a full member of the space station crew.
I've been medically certified to fly on a long duration mission as well.
So this experiment is part of that next phase to make him mission ready, so that when the opportunity does come along, he's ready for it.
Putting all the processes in place that should a flight opportunity become available, I am ready to be assigned.
And the goal is going to the ISS and doing that mission sometime in the next couple of years, right?
This is the hope. So we are looking at a flight opportunity not before 2027, so after 2027. Yeah, and it would be for a long duration mission to the International Space Station to live and work there and do what astronauts do on the space station.
We're all rooting for you, John. Now for the last experiment. Here, they're testing how we can use sunlight to move spacecrafts. Big picture, there are a couple ways to move things in space. The classic is burning stuff one way to move the object the other. But there's also shooting electrically charged particles out one way to move the object the other way. But using sunlight is different. Imagine, you'd have a spacecraft with a giant sail, and when you'd want it to move, you'd point that sail in the direction of the sun. Now, the incoming light has energy in the form of momentum, so it transfers some of that energy to the sail and pushes your little spacecraft along. And when you want to keep going in the same direction, you just turn your sail so that it no longer captures the sun's rays. In theory, you could keep doing this with other stars, just farther and farther away. And here's the really cool thing. Real missions have proved that this kind of propulsion, this photonic propulsion, can work. But we still don't understand the details of how this really works. So so it's hard to make it better. That's where this experiment comes in. Inside here, they're using laser light to mimic the sun's rays. It shoots out here and hits a mirror, redirecting it upwards to a bunch of samples made of different materials.
So once the laser hits the sample, it like...
Oh, cool, yeah. Motion.
Learning how to harness this could be huge, because the traditional methods that we use to move stuff in space require the spacecraft to carry all of its future fuel with it, and it can only carry so much. Using light to move things forward could be a fuel-free way to explore the cosmos. Huge if true.
How's it going?
In this experiment, we're still comparing. We just got the results, mm-hmm. but our experiments have been successful so far. We're getting results, getting motion mm-hmm. in microgravity, but we're still yet to compare it with the results we have from ground. Hopefully, we will publish something soon about it.
Science like this matters for you and me, because we don't know what we'll find. We don't know what we're capable of. Smart people are working all the time to learn more and push us just a little bit farther. And if you want to see that, if you want more optimistic science and tech stories, subscribe.